your prayers. Also, just learned that Mrs. Harbor's from the hospital in Ojai. I appreciate your prayers for that. I'm not sure when. I got a phone number and a message to call Brother Harbor at his house. Don't know how crucial it is, but I appreciate your prayers for Mrs. Harbor up there in the Ojai hospital. And we'll probably be getting by to see her very shortly. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm glad I'm saved, amen. I'm glad I know where I'm going when I die. And I thank God for it every day I'm saved. Well, I tell you what, I'm saved, and I'm also saved. Thank God I ain't worried about where I'm going when I die. And I'm not worried about where my kids are going when they die, and I'm not worried about where my wife is going when she dies, because they're saved too. And I like being around saved people. And I love being around people who are going to live, amen, and live forever. I don't like being around dead people and people that I know are going to hell. There's just no hope. It's just, because I never have been good for saying goodbye, good at saying hello, see you again sometime, wherever there's a hope. But whenever there's a sure enough goodbye and departure where you know you'll never see him again, boy, that just makes my heart sink. Yeah. I hope he's okay. I'd like to see that saint make it to the rapture, amen. I'd get anything to see your face on the way up too. Has anybody got a testimony tonight? Anybody got a testimony? Miss Debbie? Got a testimony this evening. Anybody else? Brother Dean. It's a blessing when something works, amen. Because you plug it in and it works. Cross for us, amen. Anybody else got a testimony this evening? Brother Vernon? Mrs. Johnson. Thank you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, somebody else have a testimony this evening? That'd be quick. Around the house. Brother Cena. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Good camp? Before we get started. Anybody else? Okay, if you would please turn in your Bible to the book of Mark, Gospel of Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8 and verse 34. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake, and the gospel the same, shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh into the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Heavenly Father, I ask your blessing on this message. Father, I pray that you bear witness to it. God, I pray that you use it. I pray that you honor it, Lord God. And I pray that you burn it into all of our hearts. God, help us to live by it. And Father, I pray that your words tonight would follow the ground, Father, like you told Samuel. And God, I pray, Lord, tonight that your word would not return void either. God, I pray tonight that you help us not to be ashamed of our Savior, what he did for us, what he stands for, God. But I pray that you help us to give him all the honor and glory that he deserves, Lord, and help us to praise him every day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Hope you don't mind if I lose this jacket. It's getting kind of warm up here.
Merry Hall weather.
Amen. She didn't have to turn the heater on today. Thank God for that. This weather's been kind to her. Here in this passage of Scripture, I'd like to call your attention back to verse 38, where he said, "Whosoever, therefore, shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." I'd like to call this message, "Shame on you. Shame on you." You know, when I was a little child, and when I sinned or did something wrong, my mom used to tell me, "You should be ashamed of yourself." And for good reason. When you sin, you should be ashamed of yourself. If you do something wrong that you're not supposed to do, it should make you ashamed. You know, we were talking to the Marshals one evening in their bus down south when they were in one of their meetings. And we were talking about some of their daughters and some of the rules and regulations they live by their dating, and how Brother Marshall was talking about how it was his responsibility to keep his children pure until they get to the altar. And so they keep them pretty well separated as much as they can, which is easy when you travel on a bus around the country pretty much. And you're not in one place too long where you can form attachments or relationships or things like that. But they said that evening during dinner time, one of Deborah's boyfriend was over there, was eating dinner with him, and he was handing Joanna, which is, I think, the 15-year-old, her plate of food. He was helping out around the bus there and gave her plate of enchiladas or whatever it was they were having, some kind of a Mexican dish. And she got a little tongue-tied when she accepted it from Tom, who was about 20 years old, Deborah's beau, and she said, "Thank you, sugar," by mistake. She was trying to say, "Thank you, sir." And as Marshall said, both of them just turned beet red from here on up. Boy, they were so embarrassed. And you know what, brother? That's refreshing to me. It's refreshing to be able to see a young teenage girl be able to blush anymore, especially in these days in which we live. You know, Adam and Eve, when they realized that they were naked back in the garden there, in Genesis chapter 3, that the Bible says they sewed fig leaves together and they covered themselves. And then when God showed up in the garden, the Bible says that they hid themselves because they were afraid. Now, what happened was that they were ashamed of themselves. They sinned against God, they took of the fruit, and then all of a sudden they were as gods, they knew the difference between good and evil, and they discovered that they were naked, so they were ashamed and hid themselves. And well, you know, nobody had to teach them how to be ashamed. And we live in a culture nowadays where they tell you there's nothing to be ashamed about. Everything that we do is perfectly natural, thus being animals the way we are, just being a higher form of animals. There's really nothing to be ashamed of. But you know, God put in every one of us, and in our conscience, we're born with a conscience that tells us that we're ashamed of ourselves whenever we sin and ever we do wrong. However, this world has seared everyone's conscience so bad that it's hard to get anybody to even blush anymore about some of the embarrassing sins that they commit. I was mentioning this morning in the message of how we used to go street preaching. One of the places we used to go is we used to load up in a pickup truck and we'd drive down to the beach in the middle of summer and go through with some of the arcade parking lots there on the pier and preach from the back of that pickup truck. And we had teenage boys mock us so bad that some of them would even pull their trunks down and shoot us the moon there while we were preaching the gospel from the back of that pickup. And then the young teenage girls, 14, 15, 16, 17 years old, they'd pull their tops up. Now, brethren, they just got no shame. This world has just got no shame. The average child in this day and age is exposed to so much profanity, vice, and corruption that they've seen it all before they're 10 years old. The media and Hollywood has taught our children to despise preachers, despise church, despise the Bible, and despise Christianity. So anymore, we're just a joke. No shame. No shame. This world's too bold with its sin, brother. I like it better when they kept it all back in the closet. You know, back in the old days, I've read about in some of the old days, you used to never hear about abortions. And way back then, 20, 30 years ago, if a woman wanted to get abortion, she'd have to pay some shady MD under the table to meet her in some fleabag motel and perform the abortion there in secret because it was against the law and it was shameful. They didn't want anybody to know about it, so they did it in darkness. Here a couple weeks ago, I was reading about the newspaper, front page news, how 500 to 700,000 pro-choice activists marched on Washington, D.C., and they just surrounded the Washington Monument there in front of the Capitol building. They had slogans on some of their picket signs which read like this: religion is a joke, and pro-life is the cruel punchline. And when they go to extremes to try and justify their sin, they say abortion is being used in order to preserve life. The mother may fall into some sort of a life-threatening position to where they might have to take the fetus in order to save her life. Well, that might be okay. I said it might be okay if that was the situation. However, abortion is not being done for family planning or life-threatening situations. It's being used as a contraceptive for illegitimate offspring from fornication and adultery. And people are selling out $150, $200 a pop for unwanted pregnancies rather than reap what they've sown and pay for their sin and their lasciviousness. However, 750,000 pro-lifers marched in the same place about 4 months ago and received absolutely no media coverage at all from ABC, CBS, or NBC. Totally lopsided. Totally one-sided. And I don't know who you're planning to vote for, and I'm not allowed to advocate any kind of a candidate from the pulpit, but I can tell you one thing. Bill Clinton was marching right along with the pro-choices against those that are for abortion and making abortion legal. Arm in arm. Sodomites march in broad daylight anymore, promoting their sex perversion and propagating their demented lifestyle. Society has failed to respond to this shameful behavior with capital punishment, as it's set forth in Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13, and Romans chapter 1, verse 38. These people get on Phil Donahue and Geraldo Rivera, and they ask them the extreme question in order to prove their point. Well, what do you think we should do with them? Do you think we should just exterminate them? And nobody's willing to go that far to say, yeah, I think you should. God told them to. God told them to take them outside the gates of the city and stone them to death. You know, they're asking all these church officials, these priests, and televangelists what they think of this. Is it Thomas Harris, Robert Harris, who was supposed to be executed Monday morning? They had a stay of execution because they felt that the gas chamber was inhumane. Well, I'm a little disappointed myself to see him put in the gas chamber. I'd rather see a public hanging myself. And the capital punishment was instituted in order to be performed as a deterrent. Deterrent. And therefore, I think it should be done in public. So all those looking on, whether they're in their right mind or out of their mind, know that if they commit the same kind of crime, they'll have to pay the same kind of punishment. So God has to take over. We fail to respond. So God has smitten these sodomites with what we call AIDS. What we call AIDS. And they may be afraid to say that on Geraldo and Ted Koppel, but brother, I'm not afraid to say it. According to Romans chapter 1, verse 27, they received the recompense of their reward. We fail to perform God's laws, God will perform it for them. And if you can't amen that, brother, then you better quit watching Phil Donahue and staying up late and watching that old Ted Koppel. You know, when you violate the laws of nature, you violate the laws of God who created the laws of nature. And I tell you what, as discreet as I can possibly put it, however speak plain to where you can understand me, whenever you unite a reproductive organ and its secretions with a digestive organ and its secretions, you are bound to have a negative biological reaction. How's that for making sense? And brother, that's just what's going on. They're having a negative biological reaction, and they will not give up their sin in order to save their own lives. It's enough to make your skin crawl. And I like it better when they catch it in the closet, brother, because when I see one on the sidewalk in the shopping mall, brother, I mean, the hair comes up on the back of my neck, and I want to get as far away from them as possible. Why? Because they're a freak of nature. And I tell you what, if Godzilla was walking through the middle of that mall, it would give me the same impression, because he's a freak of nature, too. And it's enough to make a natural man's skin crawl. No shame. No shame. And you know, Christians, we get bold with our sins too. And it was refreshing to see, I was talking about the Marshall girl, when the Blunkalls were here, that one young Blunkall girl, the middle one, I forget her name, but she called me Jimmy instead of Pastor one evening here after the meeting, and she got so embarrassed she turned red and she covered her face like this with the Bible. She was embarrassed that she called me Jimmy instead of Pastor. I know some of you apologize. I've been hearing so many apologize to all you people calling me Jimmy instead of Pastor. And in an effort to get it right, that's fine. I'm not used to hearing it either. But this gal, she actually blushed and covered her face with shame. And then on the other hand, I hear preachers get some teenagers in their church, and they'll go out and they'll neck in the parking lot when church is being let out after the morning services just to be spiteful. No shame. No shame. Romans 6:21 says, What fruit had ye then, and those things whereof ye are now ashamed, for the end of those things is death. And brethren, I submit to you that there are a lot of things that you should be ashamed of, but Jesus Christ is not one of them. You should never be ashamed of your Lord and Savior. You should never be ashamed of the fact that He is the Creator. Jesus Christ is the Creator. The Bible says in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. In John chapter 1, verse 1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And verse 3, it says, all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Jesus Christ, the Word of God, is the Creator. Jesus Christ is God. And we should never be ashamed of that. Now suppose one day here during school, say Sarah Prather or Christy Vernon or RT back in the back there sitting in their biology class at Buena High School during one of their evolution indoctrinations, and the biology teacher gets up there and he's teaching them the doctrine, the theory of evolution as its doctrine, and indoctrinating them with this theory. How do you think it'd go over, Brother R.T., if you stood up during question and answer time and said, teacher, what do you think about the theory that Jesus Christ created the universe? How do you think you'd be received? Or how do you think you'd be received, Christy, if you said, oh, I believe Jesus Christ is the one who created this universe and this world and everything that's in it? I'll tell you what would probably happen. You'd probably be laughed to scorn. And you might even be sent to the office and talk to your counselor. And you might even be suspended for disrupting the class. But I tell you what, that's the way they work. They would be laughed to scorn because these intolerant bigots are opposed to any other theory of origin other than their own. Therefore, they intimidate by peer pressure any opposition that arises against this one singular theory of origin which they teach in our public school system. And they make your kids ashamed of believing an old archaic fairy tale such as creation. Am I right? Am I right? Amen. Amen, I'm right. I've seen it happen, heard it happen. I know it happened. It happened even when I was going to school. And thanks to places like the Creation Science Institute, these atheists are under a lot of pressure right now. And they're backing up a few steps here and there, and they're even getting in a couple of schools every now and again where they have to teach both theories of origin, both theories of creation and evolution in the classroom. We no longer have to accept the evolutionist word for it. I tell you what you do. Next time your biology teacher stands up and talks about evolution, ask them. Ask them if they could possibly reconcile Darwin's origin of the species with the first and second law of thermodynamics. Tell you what, they can't do it. First law being energy and matter cannot be created or destroyed. The second law of thermodynamics is there's always entropy in a closed system. Things never wind up, things always wind down. And the fact that you work on something to keep it going introduces the fact that there is an outside source in creation, an outside help that keeps everything going, keeps everything in motion. If dates are established by layers of sediment, Mr. Biology teacher, how come there are no fossils in the pre-Cambrian strata? How come? The strata dates back to where they say dinosaurs lived, and yet there's no fossils in the pre-Cambrian strata. They just found out that the Brontosaurus was a fabrication. They just switched heads and skulls and teeth on the brontosaurus in their museums because they figured that it ate a different kind of vegetation, therefore it must have needed a different kind of teeth, so they fabricated a new head and stuck it on this brontosaurus. And now they're finding out that it was some of the bones they gathered to put this thing together were so scattered apart that it's just a hoax under pressure from places like the Creation Science Institute. The Piltdown Man, he is a missing link found, they say lived back 445,000 years B.C., was discovered by Charles Johnson in 1912. 40 years after the discovery, after these scientists held him up as the missing link, a group of scientists got together and they found out that Johnson fossilized the jawbone of a modern ape by staining it with iron salt and bicarbonate and introducing it as a missing link. You know, in 1833, Charles Darwin visited some South Sea Islands, and he was looking for a primitive tribe that he might be able to deem as the missing link. He found a tribe of cannibals there that would prove his theory. He said nothing could lift these natives from their primitive environment to their next evolutionary rung in the ladder. He returned to those islands, those same islands, 34 years later, to gather more data for his theory, only to find churches and homes and schools occupied by these same cannibals as a result of the missionary efforts of John G. Peyton, who had been there proclaiming the gospel. Darwin was so moved himself that he made a contribution to the London Missionary Society on his behalf. In the Apollo 8 crew that went to the moon, Frank Borman, James Lovell, and William Anders read the creation story from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 10 in an old King James 16 Elizabethan English Bible on Christmas Eve from the surface moon, on the lunar surface. It was an unannounced telecast in which they just kind of broke into the radio and figured they'd read creation story on Christmas Eve. Evidently, their space travel did not convince them of evolution. They looked out in space and kind of realized that, hey, this had to have been done by a creator. He was Jesus Christ. And I tell you what, brethren, if they aren't ashamed of Jesus Christ as the creator, you shouldn't be ashamed of Jesus Christ, the creator. He was also the Christ. We should never be ashamed of the fact that Jesus was the Christ. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus said, "Whom do men say that I am?" to his disciples. And they said, "Some say you're John the Baptist, others say you're Elias. Some even say you're Jeremiah." Christ returned the reply and he said, "But whom say ye that I am?" Finally, Peter piped up and he said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." That word Christ means God's anointed. He's the anointed. He was the chosen one of Israel, God ordained to bring salvation to mankind. God chose one Savior. Not many. God chose one Savior. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." When you speak in absolutes like that, you're tagged a narrow-minded bigot by this world. There are many ways to heaven, they say. You're arrogant to believe yours is the only way. You think you've got the only plan of salvation, they say. You ever heard them say that? They do. They say, "Well, all roads lead to heaven." I kind of like to look on religion as a wagon wheel, in which the outside of rim is the world, all the spokes is religion, and the hub is heaven. We're all getting there our own way. We're all working to get to the same place. Amen. And if you're not careful, you'll get there. There are many roads to Jesus Christ, but he's the only way to heaven. That's the only road. Hear him say, "Well, I believe that there is good in all religions." They play on the Christian sense of humility when they say stuff like that. And oftentimes we're too ashamed to retort or give any kind of response or an answer to the tongue or the reason of the hope that lies within it. And then finally they make us feel ashamed of our Savior for making such a dialectic, dogmatic statement such as, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Josh McDowell, in his book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, he says that Christ was either a liar or a lunatic, or he was Lord. He was one of the three. Jesus Christ left no room acknowledging as being just another prophet, or just a good teacher, or just another man, or some kind of physician. He was either God, or he was a deliberate liar and made deliberate false claims, or he was sincerely deluded and didn't operate on all eight cylinders. As the saying goes, he was probably three bricks short of a load, the world said. Great Britain historian by the name of William Lecky, he said, Christianity has presented the world with an ideal character which has inspired the hearts of men with an impassioned love through all the changes of 18th century. He said that Christ has impacted all ages, all nations, all temperaments, and all conditions. He said that Christ is not only the highest pattern of virtue, but the strongest incentive to its practice, the practice of Christianity. In the three short years of his public life and earthly ministry, he has done more to regenerate and soften the hearts of mankind than all the disquisition of philosophers and all the exhortations of the philosophers. Does that sound like someone that you should be ashamed of? Not me. I'm not ashamed of it. Jesus proved that he was the Christ by the miracles he performed. Benjamin Warfield, Philip Schaff, and Ezra Abbott got together, and they came up with the conclusion that the New Testament accounts of Christ's miracles are as valid and accurate as have as much or more authentic support as any other historical document found in history. As is it true, it's true. Christ also fulfilled prophecy. He was the Christ who fulfilled all the prophecies written about the Christ. H. Harold Hartzler, from the American Scientific Affiliation, said that the Old Testament prophecies had a 1 in 10 to the 17th power. That's a 10 with 17 zeros coming after it, of coming through in any man in only 8 prophecies that were made. All the prophecies came true in Jesus Christ. Out of 48 of the prophecies that were made by Old Testament prophets, there was a 1 in 10 to the 157th power that they would come true in any one man. They all came true in Jesus Christ. He never reached the point where the 60 prophecies, or there are even over 300 Old Testament prophecies concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. And he fulfilled 60 of them in his earthly ministry alone. The odds against it are staggering. Christ said, though ye believe not me, believe the works, that ye may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. You still have nothing to be ashamed of. Jesus Christ was God's anointing. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by him. We shouldn't be ashamed of that, brethren. We got the gospel message. We got the right Savior. We have the message of eternal life on our tongues. And brethren, too often we're ashamed to call a man who lived 2,000 years ago the Son of God, the Savior, Jesus Christ. We should never be ashamed of the fact that he was crucified. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, but we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God. He might be foolishness to the unbelieving, to the unsaved. That might seem like a joke to them, but to us who are saved, the crucifixion is the power of God. The crucifixion was a shameful ordeal, although it was a shameful event that took place, like Brother Sam was talking about. He was mocked publicly. He was beaten publicly. He was rejected by all those he was sent to save publicly. He was stripped down to his birthday suit, open, in public. The creator of the universe, the Lord of glory, the darling of heaven, the Christ, the Savior, stripped down to nothing. And the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 6:6 that he was put to an open chain. The Bible says they spit upon him. He became a curse. They mocked on him. They railed on him. Even God forsook him as he hung on the cross and became sin for us, when he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Put to an open chain. He who knew no sin became sin. Why? For us. He became a curse for us. Cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. He bore our grief. He carried our sorrows. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. He was unselfish in love. He was unselfish in his motives. And he was unselfish in the sacrifices which he bore while he was on the cross. He did it all for you and me, brother. The Bible says that the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. He who knew no sin became sin. Why? For us. Now you know what the world calls people like that? Sucker. Chump. Patsy. Everybody's out for themselves nowadays. Whenever you see somebody sacrifice themselves for somebody else, they're what the world calls a sucker. It's a shameful practice. And you should be ashamed of them. Amen? I'm not. You know, on a tablet in a church in Algiers is the name printed Devereux Sprat, 1641. Whenever they conduct tours for this historical church, a lot of the tourists ask the question, who is Devereux Sprat? And they're given the answer that he was an Englishman who was captured with 120 others in 1641 by an Algerian pirate ship. He was made a slave and put to work on the fortifications around Algiers. He found that God's grace during that time while he suffered and labored as a slave was sufficient for him. And he often took comfort in the fact that God would redeem him one day, take him on home to glory. And he found comfort and sympathy there. He found that his fellow captives, when he found them in despair, he began to cheer them with the same words of faith and hope that he cheered himself with. He soon gathered to himself a small congregation of believers among the slaves there inside those labor camps. After several years of hard labor, his prayers were answered. With the efforts of his influential brother in England, he was offered a ransom and he was ordered to be set free. When they came to Algiers with the order for his release, his fellow captives rejoiced in the fact that he was gone, and they rejoiced with tears and were happy for their brother, Brother Sprat, who was about to be free as a result of his prayer. However, Brother Sprat was so overwhelmed by their compassion, by their love, and by their tears that he refused to accept the ransom, and he chose to remain with his fellow slaves in those labor camps for the rest of his life, where he continued to win souls and comfort those who God had brought to Christ through him. He finally died in bondage as a slave there in the camp in the fortification around Algiers. Why? For the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Unselfish. Didn't care for himself. Didn't care that he was pardoned. Didn't care that he was free. What this world might call a sucker. What this world might call a chump. What this world might call a patsy. Was he a fool? Was he a sucker? Should he have gotten out while the getting was good? Would you be ashamed of a man like that? I tell you what, his inmates weren't ashamed of him. Well, Jesus Christ did the same thing for us, and we shouldn't be ashamed of him. The Bible says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. It may be a shameful thing down here for a man to suffer such for someone else, and it may seem like a far-out, unbelievable story about Jesus Christ, how he was God manifest in the flesh, and how he walked a sinless life and then offered up himself on the cross of Calvary to pay for our sins. But up in glory, brother, it's honorable. It's honorable. And we should never be ashamed of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's stand to our feet for a word of prayer. What number do you have now? 350? Let's turn to hymn number 315. Before we get started, I'd like to have every head bowed, every eye closed. We're going to give an invitation tonight. And the invitation is this. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, we'd like to invite you to know him. We'd like to invite you to come meet him tonight. We'd like to introduce the Savior we spoke of tonight to you, and we'd like to invite you to accept the gift of God, which is eternal life, through this Savior, Jesus Christ. Here this evening, if you're saved, you know it. We have many testimonies this evening. If you're saved, you know it. You trusted this Savior we spoke of tonight. Would you lift up your hand as a testimony? Just lift up your hand as a testimony. You're saved and you know it. Let me see your right hand. Amen. Amen. That's just about everybody tonight. Let me ask you this. Are you ashamed to be called His disciple? Are you ashamed to be associated with Jesus Christ? Is there anybody here tonight that would say, "Preacher, I trusted Christ as my Savior, but I've never been baptized as a public testimony"? Is there anybody here like that? Say, "Preacher, I've never been baptized, but I'd like to be." Is there a hand anywhere? Say, "Preacher, I'm saved, but I've never been baptized." Anybody anywhere? You let me pray for you? Anybody anywhere? You know, the Bible also says that the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. The Bible says, "Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together." Is anybody here tonight say, "Preacher, you know, I'm saved and I'm baptized, but I've never really associated myself with the Christian brother. I've never joined the church, but I'd like to." Is there anybody here tonight, not members of this church, but would like to be, like to join this church? Anyone, anywhere? Say, "Preacher, I'm not a member of this church, but I'd like to be." Would you raise your hand? Anyone, anywhere? Thank you, I see that hand. Anybody else? Anybody else join this one? Say, "Preacher, I'm not ashamed to be called one of God's children. I'm not ashamed to be associated with God's children. I'd like to join this church." Anybody else, anywhere? All right, as we sing First Invitation on the First, you raise your hand tonight, you come down, present yourself for salvation, present yourself for believers' baptism, present yourself for church membership, open invitation tonight, whatever your need may be. Why don't you come on as we sing on the first, 3:15. "My life, my love, I give to thee. Thou Lamb of God, who died for me. Oh, may I ever faithful be. My Savior and my God." Won't you come as we sing on the second? "I now believe thou dost receive, for thou hast died that I might live, and now..." Sing out if you know it. Won't you come as we try and sing? Won't you come? Anybody, anywhere, come on down the aisle and present yourself for salvation, baptism, or church membership. Okay, that's all for tonight. Brother Bob Allport, will you dismiss us in prayer? Amen. Amen. Lord bless you. Good night.